Welcome to Simple Health Radio, the podcast about recognizing medical emergencies and promoting wellness throughout your journey in life. Your host is Dr. Emran, a respected physician who's treated thousands of people just like you over the past 10 years. Listen to the show each week on iTunes, iHeartRadio, Spreaker, and 3 and Out Radio Network. Information provided on this show is not a substitute for professional medical advice. Always discuss your questions with your doctor or go to your nearest emergency room immediately.
Thank you so much for joining me today on Simple Health Radio. I'm your host, Dr. Emran. On today's episode, we have a very unique guest. This is an individual who is very active on social media, who's also a practicing physician, and he's someone that I've been able to coordinate with remotely, and he's a very, very humorous fellow, but also very, very knowledgeable in his subject, and so we were very pleased today to have a special guest. His name is Doc Around the Clock. Thank you so much for being on the show.
Well, thanks so much. It's my pleasure. I really appreciate you reaching out to talk about this.
Absolutely. So, Doc, tell me a little bit about your background and sort of the patient care that you've seen. Do you have a lot of experience in emergency medicine or more hospital-based medicine?
Sure. Yeah, I'm happy to kind of go through that. So my background is I am a pediatric emergency medicine physician practicing, and I also spend time as an administrator. I'm a medical director for our Children's Hospital Emergency Department where I work, and I started as after med school, I did a pediatrics residency, and then where I ended up was doing another 3-year fellowship in pediatric emergency medicine. And so I've been out of training now for about 5 years or so, and currently I'm still practicing, but as I said, I spend part of my time doing administrative work as well in the emergency department.
Excellent. Very good. So you've had quite a bit of years under your belt, and I'm sure you've seen and done just about everything that's out there.
You know, every day I think I have, and then the next day it'll kind of surprise you that, as you know, you come across something you've never seen or even thought that you'd experienced before. So I think it's kind of part of the excitement of why we do what we do.
Absolutely. No, I agree with you on that. Now, on the social media, how you and I got connected is that you post several small bits of humor throughout the day, and you take patient cases and you kind of show us the lighter side, if you will. In the work that you do, of course, you see the awful stuff, you know, the trauma, the eye injuries, and some of the surgical complications, but you always seem to find a way to lighten the mood a little bit. And every time I read your postings, I can't help but laugh because I feel like I was there in the room with you as you're describing this. So tell us a little bit about that. How did you find out that the humor that you use is so relevant? How did you find out it connects with other people in this special way?
Well, first of all, thanks for saying that. I don't feel that all my posts all the time are as humorous as I intend them to be, so I appreciate that someone's out there smiling a little bit at them and appreciating it. I'm fairly to the kind of online world of Twitter and getting into the type of discussion with other professionals. I have been someone for years that I think I've used humor just in my daily practice, both with patients and their families and then with my colleagues as well, but I've never really, until the last few months, that larger online world, which admittedly I was quite taken aback by in terms of the breadth and scope of just how much is out there. Yourself being very involved in social media, you know that you can find any number of world experts posting on advocacy issues, research, really anything online. And for whatever reason, I probably have been just watching what happened 6 to 12 months and just be more of a consumer. And at some point, with my experience and with my at least perspective on things, the way that I guess maybe internally deal with some of the stuff that I deal with, I wondered if some of that perspective and try to turn it into something that other people could relate to and other people could find some sort of connection with, because the things that humor in medicine does is allows us not only to connect to our patients, but to connect a much more compassionate way. And I think that's one of the things that we can maybe talk about down the line is, you know, how do we make sure that the humor that we are using isn't at the patient's expense? You know, I would never want any of my musings to be thought of by a patient as picking on one particular person or having a patient, oh my gosh, my doctors and nurses are all making fun of us once they leave my patient room. That's certainly, at least from my perspective, not the intent, but really just a way to kind of say, gosh, this is ridiculous, kind of what we do on a daily basis and the things that we see and the things that we're, how can we see some of the humanity in this, but also some of the humor, because a lot of what we see on a daily basis and things that we because frankly, it's funny.
Absolutely, sure. And you're right, there's a very fine line between what we see as humorous and what a bystander or someone without any medical experience would consider a little bit morbid, if you will. And I think there's a little part of what I call deconditioning, meaning after you've been in medical school, residency, fellowship for so many years, you don't get scared by, open fractures, and you don't get scared by people with knife wounds and all kinds of horrible things, whereas someone who's a family member, of course, they would be in shock, just to see that for the very first time. And so I think as a society, we've actually taken a little bit of that through TV and through other media forms and just kind of become numb to it, if you will. And so humor, I think, is actually an outlet. I think humor is a way of actually humanizing the experience. I don't know if you've done any research on that or if you have some other conferences or things like that that you've attended where they've touched on that subject.
Yeah, it's a great question. I agree with your take on it. I think one of the things that humor in medicine, I think, if you were, I guess I'll say it this way, if you were to read any of my posts and kind of put them up against world-class comedians, the humor that I'm bringing is nothing very astounding. It's silly puns, it's silly observations about things, but I think the reason it tends to work in medicine is for the reasons you suggest, which is there's a significant contrast between the seriousness of what we deal with and even being able to look lightly at a situation and find some little bit of bright humanity in it. And so when you point out that humor, it makes it that much more surprising and that much more humorous for the observer, because it's not what you expect. That's kind of in my brief kind of readings on the academic part of humor and medicine, why it works is that we are dealing with such serious subject day in and day out, and something that really touches all of humanity. Everyone knows someone who's been sick, gravely ill, or themselves, and to be able to find and inject a little bit of humor into situations when appropriate catches people off guard, but it's often what makes the situation that much better and actually connects the person who's taking care of the patient to you. And it really is something that you don't have to be a comedian or someone who is the life of the party to see humor medicine, but really be willing to step back and say to yourself, we are all humans kind of going through this crazy life together. Let's point out the things and be honest about the things that we just find funny. But again, going back to that idea, we don't want it to be at the patient's expense.
Certainly. No. And that's not the intent. I don't think anyone comes in to their shift wanting to be malicious. It's just one of those things where if you've seen the same thing over and over again, I think there's almost not a stereotype, but maybe sort of a classification. I work in the ER as well, and I can always see when I look up at the board and I see my tracker and someone checks in with two patients, it's a mother and a child or two siblings. And we always have this joke, it's two for one day, where one person's coming into the ER, the other person might as well check in as well. And you would think, wow, that's a mean thing to say. Maybe they're both really, really sick. Maybe they're both really having some horrible disease. And then we look at the chief complaint, and it's always something so trivial, that like I need a refill of my eczema medication, or, my son was having a sore throat, so I thought I'd check myself in as well. And you would think that that doesn't connect. It just isn't something logical. And so sometimes the nurses or the staff may make a comment about that. And it's just one of those things where if we don't lighten that mood, it's almost like you'll carry that negativity into the room with you. And I think patients can actually feel that, when a doctor isn't, willing to listen or willing to be connected with them. I think it actually causes a barrier, to their conversation.
Oh, absolutely. I think patients and families, particularly in my world, since I deal with children and their extended families, whether it be parents, aunts and uncles, grandparents, they know if you're sincere or not when you step in the room. And if they can read your body language, they can tell by tone of voice if you're didn't truly care about them or not. And in my own personal experience, I've just found that finding little ways to joke with families, and the kids in particular, is a very striking and very powerful way to let the family know that you care about their kid. Even simple things, an example that I guess I use in the emergency department a lot, it's kind of my shtick. I've got a few little jokes I kind of tend to use with kids, but even getting them to talk and warm up to a provider is a hard thing sometimes. And I like to ask kids who they have brothers and sisters, do you have any brothers or sisters? And they say, yes. I like to ask them, does your brother pick on you? And they say, oh, yeah. And I look them square in the eye and say, do you pick on them? And kind of give a little wink, and they kind of smile, and then they, yeah. And the parents always chuckle, the kid kind of chuckles, and we share this lighthearted moment, which, again, is not outstandingly funny, but it allows everybody in the room to take a deep breath, calm a little bit, and know that for those few moments when I'm in the room, particularly in the midst of a busy emergency department, that I'm trying to connect with them on a different level and letting them know I'm listening, I care about you, and I want to make sure that I'm treating you as a normal human being, not just as a chief complaint or as a diagnosis that I need to make.
Definitely. No, and I think that's a very wise approach, is actually going to the child's level, kind of communicating with them in their own terms. I use the same thing, and every time I do stitches, we have a lot of kids that come in falling off the playground, you know, small injuries around the house. They come in with lacerations, and I always clean it up, and then as soon as I'm ready to start, I always say, I hope it's I do a good job. This is my very first day, my very first time ever doing stitches, and then I always let them kind of pause for a minute to kind of let that soak in, and then, of course, we all laugh about it, and I think it actually diffuses is that tension. You know, if you make a simple joke like that, even though it's obvious it's not my first day on the job, the kids are always a little bit nervous then, you know, is this really the first time ever? And then I always let them take little pictures. They seem to love selfies for some reason. So if they have an IV connected in their arm, or, you know, if they have some type of splint, I always tell them, well, you better take a selfie. You know, this is the only way you're going to prove it actually happened. And that seems to be their lingo. That seems to be their, you know, modern day way of connecting, not even physically, but just through socially. This is really how they have to prove themselves to other peers, if you will. And so I think as a doctor, we actually have to respect that, you know. And certainly if it's an older person, you know, who's never had a cell phone or iPhone, that joke isn't going to connect with them, but they may have a grandchild, you know, that's what they do. And I think it's a really kind of a humane, you know, way of kind of coordinating all of that. And of course, it's not a HIPAA violation. We're not trying to get anyone in trouble with that, but I can't tell you how many selfies have been taken, you know, at my insistence, you know, because they want to take a before and an after. And that's just our way of, like you said, you know, getting through a positive experience. And those people remember you, because we always have this press Gainey scores and surveys that get sent out after the ER visit, and 9 times out of 10 they'll remember the selfie doctor, you know, because he was the one that insisted on a selfie before they left. And that actually helps me with my administration, helps me with my peers to know what I'm doing differently. And after that episode, so many people wanted to take selfies with their own patients. You know, it's just kind of a trend now, I guess. So, but I think it's just one of the signs of the times.
I'm gonna start using that. I hope you don't mind me. Hope you don't mind me stealing that from you. I like that.
Absolutely, sure. And then tell me a little bit about sort of your future plans. So you're a very successful physician. You're very successful online, you know, social media presence. What would be the next steps for you? What are some of the ideas that you have? Public speaking, you know, conferences, Saturday Night Live. You know, have you thought about what you want to do in a couple of years?
Right, yeah, this is just my day job for now until I can finally make that Saturday Night Live break I've been meaning to for all these years. You know, I think part of this is my own probably subconscious way of trying to have that success and humor that I always thought I could, and finding my own little niche in medicine where, for whatever reason, you alluded to Saturday Night Live, I am like a lot of people growing up with, you know, The Simpsons and Saturday Night Live, and sadly, it's probably pretty lame to admit, but I had a subscription to Mad Magazine growing up, and so that idea of satire and kind of finding the absurdity in just normal, regular day-to-day activities is something I just like doing. And I've been honestly somewhat surprised by the reaction to what I always thought was kind of just my own weird, absurd thoughts in my head, and trying to put them down in ways on Twitter. I've been really surprised by the reaction, and I think it's not that I do anything, I think, better than anybody else, but if anything, I think it calls to attention how much yearning there is for this type of ability to connect with our patients, and this way of dealing with what is, as you know, increasingly becoming a bigger issue in the grander scope of medicine, which is burnout and compassion fatigue. And looking for ways that our colleagues and ourselves can really keep each other sane in what often is a frankly, sometimes insane business of medicine. You know, as you mentioned press Gainey scores and being on the administrative side of medicine, often we have to make operational changes in our healthcare systems that are not tolerated well, and the people who are on the front line struggle with this. And one of the things that I've learned over time, one of the things that if I have any way of helping share how to do it better, is I like trying to bring some humor even into things, which you never think of humor in administration.